नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा।
Good morning, everyone. Today, we begin the second lecture of this series about the rupa. The previous lecture, we discussed about what rupa is and what is a cluster of a rupa and what is a generation of these clusters of rupas. So we term them as rupa is something that has an intrinsic nature, which is an intrinsic quality, but at the same time, coming together, they manifest certain physical attributes, substantial attributes, and they get extended. Then regarding the kalapas, and that was the nature of a rupa. So there's a good question was raised. Rupa in its own nature doesn't have a shape. It doesn't consume any space. It is not an extended reality. But when they come together, since they have various different attributes, they manifest physicality. They come into the sphere of physicality. Physicality means some things which are extended. So a good question was raised, how a group of realities which don't have any physical shape, how could they get manifested as physical stuff, even when they come together? So the logical answer is not a direct answer. Some sort of logical argument would be, since they possess different attributes, so their intrinsic natures are not the same, since they are the hardness, cohesion, bloating nature, and all these are different attributes, when they come together, they manifest as substances. So like the two realities, the mind and body, who are independent, unable to work due to certain deficiencies that they have. But when coming together, since their deficiencies are in certain parts, the mind doesn't have a physical attribute, so it cannot move. The body doesn't have an intention to move. But when they come together, since the body has a physical, body is a physical thing, and the mind has the intention, so when they come together, they are capable to perform, execute the action of moving. So likewise, the Patavi itself doesn't have a shape. Apo itself cannot have a shape. Vayu itself cannot have a shape. Tejo itself doesn't have a shape. So, but when they come together, they start to exist in a certain space and they become some extended reality. It's not that they became extended reality. They manifest as extended things. So that was our aim, our discussion last week. And they come in clusters. We call them Rupa Kalapas. And their generation of these Kalapas are called Rupa Santati. And there are 18 rupas in the Theravada tradition or concretely produced, and there are another 10 types of rupas that we discuss as Anipana rupas, non-concretely produced matter. We also discussed about the kalapas. We normally have 23 types of mixtures of these rupas, the kalapas, and the santatis, the generations. We normally term them as 24, but that the number can change according to the way you count. Then today we are moving to another area of this topic. It's a vast topic, the rupa. It's quite interesting. So we now move into the aspect where how matter has been explained by the canon, in the Tipitaka itself. So I'm not talking about the entire doctrine here. I'm talking about the Tipitaka, the Buddha's words, as it has been preserved by the Theravadians. So how the matter has been explained. So this is, and also today we are going to discuss about how matter can be known with direct observation, with direct wisdom, and then why it is an irreducible nature, irreducible quality, the irreducibility of rupa. So these are the three topics that we'll be discussing today. How matter, rupa, has been explained in the canon. When I say the canon, I'm referring to the Tipitaka, the first point I'm discussing. Then, direct observation of Rupa. How can we know Rupa with direct wisdom? Then, its irreducibility. So it's irreducibility. How, why it's, it cannot be divided any further. It cannot be divided into any further components. So matter, when we are talking about matter, there are three ways the matter has been explained in the canon. I think I have mentioned this in the handout as things with abundant qualities. Things with abundant qualities. Here I'm talking qualities as intrinsic natures, but since we are explaining the matter in a different way, so I would use the words quality. Then, as things which have a specific unique quality or specific unique qualities. Things with, we can call unique specific qualities. So there's another way the rupa has been explained. Then as mere material qualities, just qualities. Mere material qualities. These are three ways the rupa has been explained. When you go into normally to most of the suttas, when the Buddha wants to say the patavi, apo, tejo, vayu and so forth, which are the four great elements, he normally mentions patavi as a thing. The hair is patavi. The blood is apu. Nails are patavi. Snot is apu. So likewise, phlegm and so forth. So when we go into the sutras, what we find is, instead of calling these rupas as mere attributes, as I explained in the last lecture, I mentioned they don't have any shape. They don't manifest individually. They don't manifest any substantial qualities. Mm-hmm. When they come together, they do show such qualities, but in their own, they don't have any extended nature. But when you go into the sutras, what we find is matter has been explained as stuff, as things. Teachings are very clear. Patavi is kesa, loma, nakada. Here, hair, body hair, head hair, skin, the nails, teeth, and all so forth. All the hard parts of the body, as the Buddha has segregated the body. So, therefore, someone can have a question. Why do the Theravadians, while the Buddha has clearly explained rupa as something, as things, why do the Theravadians in their Abhidharma or in their doctrine would say that rupa are mere qualities? So what is the purpose? How do we relate them to each other? So first we should know that things as abandoned quality, for example, hair, kesa, as patavi, and blood, for instance, as apo. So blood is something, it's a liquid. It's not the liquidity. He's talking about a certain liquid as apo. Patavi kes is a hard thing, not the hardness. So this is the first way the Buddha has explained the teachings. But the thing is, why did he call hair patavi? Why did he call named blood as apu? Because patavi has the kesa or the hair has more hardness in it than the liquids. So that's why we mentioned things with abundant qualities. Abundantness is very important here. Abundantness. Why didn't he call blood patavi and didn't call kesa or the hair as apu. Because there's a clear distinction in them. That is, the stuff that he has named as patavi are with more hardness, they're solid things. They do have a specific shape. They are solid in their shape and their in their existence as things. But the, all the things that he has mentioned as apu are flowing. They are liquids. They don't have a specific shape unless they are put into a certain vessel. They just take the shape of the vessel. They cannot have a shape by themselves like the hard stuff. So it shows that this naming had a certain basis. So what was the foundation of this naming? Why did he call kesa as patavi? Why did he call nails as patavi and call blood, phlegm and so forth as apu? The reason was, even though he was explaining them as substances, they had certain physical attributes. Things which has more hardness were termed as patavi. Things which have the liquidity, which has the nature of flowing, were termed as apo. So therefore, even though we just cannot say they were just mere things, things with abundant qualities. So that's the first way of explaining the rupa. Then we come to things with unique, specific qualities. Now think about the Buddha has mentioned the rupa divided into 32 parts. At the same time, we have another teaching which divides the body into kesa, like eye, ear, nose, tongue, and so forth. So there was another explanation on this, how the Buddha has divided the body parts. So in that case, we can call eye as something, a flesh ball, ear and so forth. Even the tongue is a bunch of flesh. But still he divided them separately. Separately means the definition, the explanation based on eye, ear, nose, tongue and body is quite different from the 32 body parts. So why did he divide the body into such groups? Now one who has studied the Abhidhamma would argue that while he's saying I, he's referring to I, he was referring to the eye sensitivity or chakkur prasada. Or when he was mentioning as ear, he was referring to the ear sensitivity. But when you go into the commentaries, especially the Satipatthana commentary, when the Buddha has mentioned chakkung roke piyarupang, satarupang, the commentators explain what does it mean by chakku is something adorable. Because the eye is something, sometimes the eyes are blue, some eyes are brown, some eyes are black, and they are surrounded by eyelashes. The white liquid is there, some are shining, brighter, the shape. So when the Buddha mentioned chakkung loke piyarupang, eye is an adorable object. According to the Theravadians, he was referring to the entire eye, not only to the sensitivity. Sometimes we can, if we want, in meditation, a person, according to his preferences, could refer to the eye sensitivity. There's no problem in it. But if someone discuss the teachings based on the entire flesh eye, it's still according to the Theravada teachings. Because normally our affection comes when looking from outside, like very ordinarily, we get attracted to our eye, the nature of our eye, the shape of our eye, the beauty of our eye. But when we penetrate deeply, why eye is so attractive and why eye is so valuable? Because it has the nature of being sensitive to the colors. If that sensitivity is not there, eye becomes something not that much valuable. It would just be a part of a body, but not such a valuable body part. For example, in most of the cases, if someone is given opportunity either to cut his hand or remove one of his eyes, most of the people in the world, I think, would go to remove his arm and but to keep his eye, because the senses are more important. Hand is quite important, but still, as long as we have another hand, still we can manage it. It's easier to manage than living the life with one eye, because it's so helpful to our life. So when we penetrate into what is an eye, why do we adore the eye? We get to know, understand that the sensitivity is the most important or the prominent factor in this organ called eye. But still, when the attraction is there, when we analyze why we are so attracted to the eye, we cannot deny the fact that our attraction is also aiming or based on the shape or the nature or the color or the beauty of the eye. So when the Buddha, according to Theravadis, when Buddha mentions as eye, he is not referring only to the eye sensitivity. The entire thing, the heart thing, which also contains the sensitivity. So instead of naming it as flesh, he called it eye. Why was that? Because it has a unique, specific quality that cannot be found in any other place, and a quality that other rupas cannot, a function that other rupas cannot perform, this eye sensitivity. So therefore, eye has to be specifically mentioned in order to remove the attachment that we have towards our senses and also to our life. Life is more worthy living only when the senses are present. Otherwise, it's if some eyes, ears, and tongue and the nose is gone, even though we just have the physical feeling, there's no way that we can convey our idea. It's something not a very admired life. It's not something that anyone would prefer to live if the senses are missing. So life is so valuable to us only because the senses are there. Then someone can ask a question, what about the life in the immaterial realm, the arupa realm? So there the mindset is different, because our minds always need something from outside to satisfy ourselves. But when someone has attained arupa jhana, he is more satisfied with the object that he has rather than enjoying the world with senses. So the entire different mindset is there. So if we give just a simple example, the life in the karma realm is like mere rice, only rice. It needs some curries. When we want to have a tasteful meal, you cannot just have rice, you have to add something into it. But think about a cake, which is built. If you take the cake, the thing has one substance within itself, all the flavors are there. You don't need anything to add to it to make it more tasty. So likewise, the karma realm, the life needs objects to continue or to satisfy. But when it comes to the arupa realm, the mindset, the being who is born there, has a different mindset. So he doesn't need any other object. So he's much more satisfied with the life, with the objects that he has in the mind. So that's the main reason. So our lives become worthy living only because when there are senses. So these senses are located in specific places of the body. So those are the eye, ear, nose, tongue, and the entire body, the physical body, which has the sensitivity to the touch. So therefore, when he mentions as eye, he was referring, according to Theravada, he was referring to the entire eye. Why was that? Is it because it has hardness? No. Is it because it has more liquidity within that ball? No. Because it has a specific quality, which is the sensitivity to the color. So therefore, due to this existence of this unique quality within that matter, within the substance, Buddha named it as eye. So his classification in this regard is not because of an abandoned quality. Why did he call hair as pati? Because it has the abandoned hardness. Why did he call the entire ball of eye as eye or chakku? Because in that region, in that specific thing, it has a curtain sensitivity, which is the quality sensitive to the color. So therefore,
the classification of eye, ear, nose and tongue is based on, not based on the abandoned qualities, that is because they possess a certain unique specific attribute. For instance, eye, he called chakku, and ear, sota, and so forth. But still, he has referred to the rupa as substances, things, material things, not as mere qualities. But this naming is based on specific qualities. This is because of abandonness of such a quality. This is because of existence of a unique quality, especially the sensitivities. Then we come into another way of explaining rupa as mere material attributes or qualities, mere natures. So these teachings can be found in Dhatu explanations, so Ayatana explanations. How do we prove this? How do we understand this? Now think about Kesa, a hair, for example. Right? So this hair was termed as Patavi according to one way of teaching. But when we go into the Dhatu or Ayatana explanations, now I think some of you are aware, Dhatu Ayatana means in that explanation, Buddha mentioned I'll refer to some Dhatus. Rupa Dhatu. Then we have Gandha Dhatu. Then we have Rasa Dhatu. Pottabha Dhatu. What do they mean? Rupa Dhatu means the color. Rupa. So someone can say when he refers to the color, he is referring to some things with color. Then Gandha Dhatu. Things, someone can argue, he is talking about things with abandoned smell. Rasa Dhatu. Things with abandoned like taste. Things in which taste can be felt. Pottabha Dhatu. Which can be touched. The thing is, if we name them so, the classifications would overlap. Now think about hair. Hair is something that can be seen, so it should be called Rupa Dhatu. It has a specific smell, so it can be called Gandha Dhatu. It is tangible, can be called Pottabha Dhatu. If you put it into your mouth, there is a certain taste, obviously. So it can also be called Rasa Dhatu if this classification is also based on substances, like the previous two. Hair is, when he mentions Patavi as hair, he is referring to a substance. When he mentioned I as chakku, he is referring to the substance, which also had the sensitivity within it, but according to Theravadins, the Buddha's intention was the entire I, together with the sensitivity, a thing. But when we go into the Dhatu classification or Ayatana classification, he mentioned Rupa Dhatu, the visible form, Gandha Dhatu, the order, Rasa Dhatu, the taste, Pottabha Dhatu, the touch or the tangible object. Now some may argue that this is a classification based on material substances. If so, what happens? The same object can be explained in various ways. Hair, the only hair which was called Patavi according to one explanation, one classification, this thing can be either Rupa Dhatu, Gandha Dhatu, Rasa Dhatu and Pottabha Dhatu. Why is that? Hair can be seen, hair can be smelt, hair can be tasted and hair can be touched. So in that regard, Theravadians would say that this Dhatu classification is aiming at mere qualities rather than the substances. Why is that? Because when you take the hair as one thing, it has a visible form, visibility. It has visibility. It has a certain smell. It has a taste. It can be touched. It is tangible. So the same object has all these four qualities. So normally in most of the places, except in few occasions, in most of the places, the teachings in a classified way of teaching, by the classifications are done, normally the classifications do not overlap each other. Now, for example, any reality that falls into Rupa Dhatu cannot be classified as Dhamma Dhatu. Otherwise, the teachings would overlap. It's not necessarily to make such a classification. Classification is to group them in different groups. In rare cases, there are some realities may fall into two categories in very rare occasions, but in most of the cases, they do not overlap each other. So in that case, if you don't want to make them as not to overlap, so the only way that we can explain this Rupa Dhatu, Sabda Dhatu, Gandha Dhatu is we refer to the entire thing as a substance, that substance as a visibility, a nature that can be seen, that is the color, a nature that can be smelled, which is the smell or odor in that substance, a nature that can be tasted, a nature that can be touched. The color is not hair. Smell of the hair is not the hair. Taste of the hair is not the hair. The tangible quality of the hair is not the hair. When we say hair, we are referring to a thing that can be seen, smelled, tasted, and also can be touched, and which also has a certain shape. So when we have the idea of hair, it's a combination of all these qualities. If something cannot be seen, we cannot call it a hair. Smell or taste, we don't much refer to that, but we intellectually we know there should be something, and it has to be touched. If that cannot be touched, we cannot call it a hair, it's just a picture of hair otherwise. So therefore, when we are talking about substances, we cannot ignore the fact that there are certain qualities. So in the Dhatu Desana, Ayatana Desana, Buddha was aiming at these mere qualities rather than the substances. So therefore, it's a third type of explanation, like these referring to mere qualities. Instead of telling Patavi is hair, instead of telling blood, Apo is blood, instead of saying I is Chakku, here he has referred Rupa Dhatu, means the visibility, the nature that can be seen. We normally call it the color. Gandha Dhatu is the smell, the nature that can be felt by the nose, known through the nose. Rasa Dhatu, the nature that can be known through the tongue. Pottabha Dhatu, the nature that can be felt with the body. So therefore, these teachings are referring to Buddha has referred to Rupa as mere material attributes or qualities in these types of teachings. So therefore, I see there are three ways the Rupa has been explained in the Buddhist canon, Buddha's teachings, as mere substances but with abandoned qualities. Otherwise, there is no basis for this classification. And things that have a unique quality, like the sensitivity in the eye and so forth, and just mere material attributes, like the Rupa, Dhatu and Ayatana classifications. So that's how the teachings have been, Rupa, the teachings of Rupa can be found in the canon when you are reading the Tipitaka. And then I would like still like to go into more insight in about these two classifications. Now, these are substantial classifications. These are qualitative classification. The qualitative classification, substantial classifications. So in the substantial classifications, what is the basis for this classification? Still, it is the quality. Why did the Buddha call something as Patavi? Because it has the hardness. Someone call it because it's a hard thing. Why something is a hard thing? Because philosophically it has a hardness. A nature that can be felt. A nature that doesn't, that makes it to have a certain shape. A nature that doesn't allow any other object to penetrate through its space. This is the hardness. So therefore, even Apo, when Buddha mentioned blood is Apo, because it doesn't have a specific, and it starts to flow. So it means that this classification is also based on certain material qualities, not just out of nothing he named a certain substance, Patavi and Apo. Otherwise, his classification has no logic behind it. why something is called chakku? The why eye was called chakku? Is it because it has hardness in it, or is it because it has certain liquid in the eyeball? No, because it has a certain specific sensitivity. Sensitivity is not the hardness of the eye. Sensitivity is not the liquid in the eye. It is the nature of being sensitive to the visible form. So likewise, even these two classifications are based on material attributes. The underlying philosophy of these classifications are material attributes. So therefore, Theravadians call the rupa as mere qualities, not as substances. But when you go into the teachings, sometimes the rupa has been explained as substances due to, for the convenience of grasping the idea. But when we come into the tejo, specifically tejo, which is the heat, sometimes tejo has been explained as fire, but when it comes to the tejo within the body, it seems like always, everywhere, tejo has been explained as a mere nature, not as a substance. Normally, tejo is not referred as a substance. So if you go into the page number 3, 1.7, above that, penultimate paragraph, above the 1.7. It is also important to look at the philosophical notion behind the modes of expression used under 2.31 and 2.32. These are the classifications. 1.61 and 1.62, sorry for that. So the expressions used under 1.61 and 1.62, while defining the corporeal reality as things, the Buddha grouped body parts either based on the similarity of the dominant material quality each part possesses or based on a specific material attribute those body parts contain in the case of ear, eye, ear, nose, tongue and body. And all by this also mentions why all the body parts, the hair, the body hair, the head hair, the nails, teeth, lung, heart, all were put into one group because they also share common attributes of hardness, abundance of hardness. It reveals that the foremost concept in explaining rupa is its qualitative attribute and not its substantial appearance. It's not because of its appearance, substantial, it's because of the qualitative attributes, it seems like. Then, moreover, what has been explained in Dhatu Vibhanga, Maharavulovada and Mahahattipadopama Suttas as Patavi Gatang, Apo Gatang, Tejo Gatang, Vayo Gatang. So, it says Patavi Gatang. The word Patavi Gatang, Apo Gatang, Tejo Gatang, hardness, hardness, flowing nature, heat and pushing or blotting nature respectively, according to the Theravada tradition. So, within the Sutta, even how that commentary explains, these qualitative attributes are also mentioned. Right, so this is the point that I want to emphasize before we go into the rupa, the definition and classifications and so forth. So these are the three ways the rupa has been explained in the canon. We can find it without by ourselves. Then we are going to explain how rupa, the material realities can be empirically observed and their intrinsic characteristics and functions can be known through intellectual analysis. Here they are, therefore, hence they are ultimate natures. Ultimate natures can be known with direct wisdom. Some ultimate qualities such as the paramatta jatikas we would not be able to know it with direct wisdom, only we can infer it, them. To be a paramatta dhamma, it can be normally known with direct wisdom. So rupa has to be known, should be known with direct. Now we mentioned the rupa is mere quality, it's a mere quality. Our qualities, they are not substances. Now, how do we understand these mere the qualities which are called rupa? Now, think about a vehicle. If you think this as a vehicle, a car. Car is some sort of a thing that consumes a certain space and which can travel when the fuel is given, and which can take humans or whatever substance which is put into it from one location to another. So it has a locomotion, it moves, it can be moved, it can be driven. So this is something called a rupa. So this is something called a substance, a thing, sorry, substance. It has an extended nature. So how do we understand? This is what we experience in our day-to-day life. This also can be called rupa in one sense. We'll be discussing that when we come to the definition of the rupa. These things can also be called rupa as things in the conventional level, conventional usage according to Pali. Now what we are talking about, the qualities of rupa or material qualities can be found here. How can we know it? Now think about this, the idea of car, the entire, the space it consumes. When we look into that, I think we have discussed about this matter in the previous series, but still, as the lecture is about the rupa, I have to still again discuss on this matter. Now think about this entire thing, it consumes a certain space. From the outlined layer, it has a certain hardness spread all over that area. Why is that? You cannot penetrate into it. You cannot go through this body of the car. It occupies this entire space. Think about this podium. I cannot go through this. It has consumed the space. That is the extended nature of this thing. But when we think about it as a thing, we would think the podium has consumed a certain space. But when we look into this, not as one thing, but just to its certain attributes of this thing, we find that there is a certain hardness which has been spread all over this area. So it has been spread all over the area, right? So don't think about, I'm not emphasizing on the inside space of the car, just think it as one substance. So then thing is, there is a hardness here. It can be felt. If you touch it, we know, we can feel it. The best way to explain hardness is preventing the penetration. Preventing the penetration. Then that hardness is not scattered in the air in all the directions, but it has been kept in one location because of the bonding power of each and every atom or particles. So therefore, there is a certain cohesion. The cohesion is there. That's why the hardness is kept. Scientifically, we may have a different explanation on this. That I'll come in next week. How do we understand this hardness and cohesion logically, according to Theravada tradition, how the science explains it. And also should remind that according to science, the color is a secondary attribute which doesn't exist in the reality. It is some sort of a frequency of the light waves, color means. And smell is some sort of a feeling that we get. When the chemical reactions happen in the cells, receptor cells of the nose, and the objects, the certain molecules come and have a contact. Even the taste. So touch and also the touch, all these sound, color, sound, taste, touch and the smell are secondary attributes. According to physics, they do not exist in reality. What exists are the quarks, electrons, neutrinos, and the energy force-carrying particles. And these are the things that really exist according to physical science. So, but Theravadins take a different approach. So, this hardness is not scattered in the air because they are being bounded with each other. And also, we can feel there is a certain kind of a heat or a coldness, whatever. is in that entire area. You think about a hard substance like a pole, it's in the entire place. The heat is there, the hardness is there. And that hardness is kept in a certain location without letting it to get scattered. Now think about only these three qualities existed. Hardness is being pushed inside. It's like it's kept inside. Now in this regard, and go into the particle. Small particles, there is a attraction between these two. There is an attraction which we call the how the elements react within each rupaka, interkalapa four elements, and also this hardness itself within a kalapa, within a small substance, is kept in that location because of an inward power that works inside. So that. If so, the entire thing would collapse because it cannot have a specific shape because the force is towards the central location. It's something that pushes inside. To prevent this instability by nature, there is a certain power or a force that works to the outer side. So only when there is such a push outside, now this is a different logical explanation, not scientific explanation. So when the hardness is there, hardness has been kept in one location because of a bonding nature holding it there, and heat also is located in that area. But why doesn't it completely collapse? Because there is a outward push. Now if you think about this phone, there is hardness in all this, in this entire area, but it has to shrink inside if only the cohesion exists. So to prevent that, there is a force which works to the outside. So that force is called the bloating nature or the pushing nature. So when these four qualities, the hardness, heat, cohesion and the bloating nature exist together, what happens in different ratios? A certain shape starts to appear. If you think about a pole, a wooden stick, so the entire, now this is a three-dimensional thing, right? So this entire, in this entire space, there is hardness. The cohesion has kept it in one location, in this area. But still, as it is a force to the inside force directed towards inside, it has been balanced by a force to the outer side. So that is the pushing nature. So then when they become stable, the hardness can exist in a certain space, and there is a heat existing all over that place as well. So this is how, now these four natures can be felt with our intellectual understanding. We will not be able to see them as we explain in words when we go into scientific experiments. They may have a different explanation, but observing them with our normal understanding, this explanation seems very logical. So there is a hardness. Now this is how we feel it from outside. Now from next week, I'll be explaining how these four forces are acting even at the atomic level. How do we understand it according to Theravada tradition, even at the Rupa Kalapas, within the Kalapa, inter Kalapas, like means within the groups of Kalapas and so forth. So that lecture, now we are going into a, we may go penetrate into it and understand how do we explain it sort of scientific, not scientifically, like with more acute analysis. So then what happens when the four great elements, these were the called four great, these four great qualities, when they exist, happen to exist in a certain space, according to Theravadians, another specific quality happens by nature. So when the four great elements are there, a quality which is sensitive to the eye happens to appear there, which we call color. So that's why color can be known. When we call about a car, color. What is a color? Color is the nature that is sensitive to the eye. So the main attributes of physicality are these four qualities. If any of these qualities are not present, the entire physical world would collapse, according to Theravada. They can exist without the color and all. Color are secondary. Secondary means, it doesn't mean that they are not realities. They have their own existence, but based on the four great elements. The four great elements, the four great qualities are imperative in the physical world. Among them, even the Patavi is the most prominent, which I'll be discussing from next week about the Rupa Kalapa. So when the four great elements come together, there appears a color, which is sensitive to the eye. There appears a smell, odor, which is sensitive to the ear. Sorry, nose, beg your pardon, then a taste, which is sensitive to the tongue, and also something called a nutriment. Nutriment means after the creatures eat this stuff, it can produce certain energy within the body. I think you are aware that there are certain humans that can survive by eating hard stuff like the metal, glass, and so forth. There's a Guinness World Record for eating a plane. I think he took a few months to finish, 6 months to finish the entire plane. So he has eaten bicycles, cars, tires, tube lights, and all sort of things. I think unfortunately he passed away recently. So they are human, and even some creatures can survive by eating certain stuff that we don't normally eat. So therefore, according to Theravada tradition, whenever the four great elements come together, a certain quality appears within it, which is capable in producing energy, having gone into the digestive system of a living being. Unless it has gone into the digestive system of the living being, it is unable to produce the energy. So that quality, which is responsible for this production of energy, is called nutriment according to the teachings. That we call normally as oja in Pali terms. So these terms, if we write them in Pali, hardness is patavi, cohesion is apo, heat is tejo, pushing nature is vayo, or blotting nature, color is vanna, or sometimes we call it rupa as well, smell is ganda, taste is rasa, nutriment is oja. I have given them in the handout as well. So they can be known empirically, because observing it, either with mind or the senses, we can feel all this. So normally in Buddhism, we don't go into the scientific like sort of experimental level. So with direct wisdom, that can be known. That is enough for our insight meditation. So all these four qualities can be logically known with thought experiments. Thought experiment means is that something that doesn't need any scientific research. It can be known with our wisdom. So if something can be known with the wisdom, either with direct experience or with inference, that is considered as a reality. This is considered as a reality. So all these qualities which are called rupa can be known either with direct wisdom or with inference. So therefore, these rupas are mere qualities, are all paramarthas. They do exist in nature. Then we come into the third topic, irreducibility. Now the car, for instance, there was something called a car, according to our understanding. There was a car. So this car can be put into certain parts. The wheels can be separated, the metal stuff, the steering wheel. So this is a combination, these body parts, the spare parts we call, or the body parts of the car. So car means when these parts come together and locate in the space in a certain manner, car is an idea that we get looking into how they are connected. So if the wheels are located vertically or horizontally, and if the shape changes, rather calling it a car, we may call it something else. So car is something, the car means an idea which we synthesize in our mind, looking into the manner these parts are being allocated or assembled. When the parts are removed or segregated, dissected, what happens? The idea of car disappears. We may call it just a bunch of body parts. No, body means the spare parts or whatever, metal parts. So can't we say that the car means these parts? No, because even a casual bundle of these parts should be called a car if so. If the body parts are the car, even a casual one, however they are located, however they are assembled, it has to be called a car. So we normally don't use that. We normally don't think so. Why is that? Because the idea of car is based on the way these parts have been assembled. So therefore, car is not something that really exists. It's something that exists in our mind. It's a way that how we consider the outside, looking into these physical things, how they are assembled. So even a single body part can be further divided. So then we can see something that can be known that there are certain particles. Even scientifically, it has been proven. There are certain particles separated from each other. So this was the normal Eastern knowledge in the Eastern philosophy, that Paramanu, the idea of Paramanu. Dalton and Democritus expressed this idea in the Greek philosophy. In the Indian traditions, they had this idea of atom. Atom means the tiniest particle, not as in terms of electrons and protons and quarks and so forth, but separate particles which have their independent existence apart from others. So it's not a one thing, they are units. The matter exists in units. So then, while dividing into smaller parts, we may end up in the tiniest particle that cannot be further divided physically. So we call it the Rupa Kalapa. We call it Rupa Kalapa. So with this Rupa Kalapa, which I'm going to discuss in detail from next week, when we look into it, we can feel a certain hardness there. That hardness is kept in that location because of inward power, cohesion, and there's a heat. Both heat and the hardness are kept there because of cohesion, which is working inwards. But if only these three qualities remain, the entire thing would collapse. To prevent that, there is a push that goes into the outer side. So what happens? Due to this push to the outer side, the entire thing doesn't collapse. Because of the inward force, the thing would not get blasted. Thing would not get scattered because of the outer force. So they are balancing this entire thing. So what happens? Even the tiniest particle, though it cannot be physically reduced, it can be reduced intellectually. It can be reduced intellectually. So according to Theravada tradition, the smallest thing is not a particle. So they are the attributes of the particles, which can be known intellectually only. So the existence of these mere qualities, when these mere qualities come together, they manifest as a particle. At the same time, the color, taste, tongue, color, smell, taste, and the nutriment would also occur together with them. So the car can be reduced into its parts. A single part can be reduced into particles. A single particle can be reduced into qualities. Single particle. Hardness, cohesion, heat, blotting nature. So this can be divided. Intellectually, we can see these attributes. When they come together, they manifest as a substance. So even the smallest particle, which we call the Rupa Kalapa, according to Theravada, can be divided further. But hardness, you cannot reduce into any parts, because hardness is just a quality. You cannot put it into any substantial qualities. Scientifically, they may have a different explanation what hardness is. That I will try to explain the next week. How do we understand this? What the Theravadins mean? But hardness, if you just focus on the hardness conventionally from looking into it, not in with the deep scientific explanation. So if you look into the hardness is a quality that cannot be reduced any further. Cohesion cannot be reduced. Heat cannot be reduced. Bloating nature cannot be reduced. So therefore, the rupas that are advocated within the Theravada tradition. No, here actually, these are the rupas advocated by the Theravadians. So the rupa that has been advocated by the Theravadians are irreducible. This is reducible. Reducible. Sorry for the spellings. These all are reducible. Even the smallest particle is reducible. This is irreducible. So when we say ultimate realities, they are irreducible natures of the world. If something can be reduced into its components or into its ingredients, it's not considered as ultimate reality. So therefore, Rupa is an irreducible nature according to Theravada. So today that will be the lecture. Today we discuss three main topics. How the Rupa has been explained within the Theravada canon. sometimes rupa has been explained as things with abundant qualities, things with specific qualities, and also mere material attributes. And then how do we understand rupa with direct observation and the irreducible nature of rupa? So rupa can be known with direct understanding or intellectual analysis, as we had, as we experienced regarding the car. And then when we go into intellectual analysis of reducing into its components or the ingredients, at the end the rupa that we get as natures cannot be reduced any further. So this knowledge is quite important to our insight meditation, because if you understand rupa in that level, even though rupa, we contemplate rupa as things according to the sutras, but still we should know what is the basis of this classification. These are the qualities, mere qualities. If without mere qualities, Buddha would not be able to group certain things as patavi and apu. So the very basic fundamental of rupa is the base material qualities. A quality can never be a self. Quality doesn't deserve to be called I. There are just natures. Patavi is just the hardness. Cohesion, apu is just the cohesion. So this body is a combination of these force or these material qualities. Rather than calling them forces, I would call them qualities. So each and every quality, when you start to analyze in insight meditation, focusing on each and every quality separately, the mind would start to say, no, this hardness can never be I, because it's not our nature to consider something which is hard, just the hardness as I. Just the cohesion cannot be I, the heat cannot be I, the bloating nature cannot be I. So what we have to do is, there's the very simple activities there, just to focus on these qualities separately, one after another. So while we keep on doing it, the mind would start to automatically say that this cannot be a self. And then when your wisdom starts to grow sharper and the concentration develops, you will find that there is no other, any other thing other than these mere material qualities. So you will not be able to find a self in this body. So that's why it's utterly important that you understand the rupa in this level. This would facilitate the development of insight meditation more quicker, swiftly you'll be able to attain insight understanding. So that would be the lecture, so with further explanations we'll come closer to understand what rupa is and its non-self nature. Yeah, thank you for listening. Yeah, I'll give you the opportunity to raise the questions.
Hello everyone. So as usual, if you have any questions, you can raise your hand or you can put your question in the chat box. I'm going to start by reading the questions we had left over from yesterday. So the first question is, what are the causes of Mahabodha? Is it Vijnana? If so, then where are Mahabodha coming from before that? Because what they said that they are realities that exist in a manner. So what is that manner? Is that manner perceivable?
Yeah. So I would call these are hard questions. In science, we have hard questions about the consciousness. These are the hard questions in Buddhism. So now, I never said that the origin of Mahabhuta is Vijnana. I think maybe I mistakenly mentioned, but normally that's not how the Theravadians say. Mahabhuta is not a creation of Vijnana. Mahabhuta can be known through Vijnana. Mahabhuta can be known through Vijnana. They exist in a certain manner. What do you mean by certain manner? They do exist. They do, there are different combinations, but they have their own independent existence. Rupas do exist in clusters. Then they can never be found in their individuality. Hardness can never exist alone without cohesion and so forth. So this is how the rupa exists. In this rupa, in this cluster, we have hardness, patavi, cohesion, apu, heat or coldness, tejo, and pushing nature or bloating nature. Outside pushing, cohesion, the inside. So these are the four qualities, they do exist. So I'm not sure what the question was regarding the manner. So now these great elements can be known with vijnana. But they may be known in a different manner. For example, instead of knowing now these rupas come together and they may form a human being, like appear as a human being, instead of knowing they as different material qualities, we would rather perceive it as a man, a human. The idea of human is something in the mind, but this is the reality. They do, according to Theravada, they do exist, but we consider them as something else. So this is the ignorance. Why this idea came into the mind? Because of this sanya or vedana or rupa, ditti and so forth. This is a mentality. This is not a mentality. This is an image. I would call it a mental image for the easiness. We call it nimitta in Pali. Nimitta, mental image. I would translate it as mental image, but it doesn't mean that a new rupa is created there. This is how the mind takes the outside world. The reality is there, but it is taken as a human or a self or a permanent thing. Sometimes it has as the reality. Sometimes the mental image can be corresponding to the reality. Most of the cases against the reality. So according to Theravadians, rupa is not a product of mind. Whether he or she perceives this, or even if he perceives something else, still this rupa exists. There is no contribution from the consciousness for this rupa. It has its own independent existence, regardless of the observer. It's a very basic fundamental in the Theravada tradition. It's a very basic fundamental. Yogacharas mention only consciousness appears, everything is in the mind. It's an illusion. The four great elements are found here. Everything is, even the concepts are found here. There's nothing outside. So only consciousness exists. And they try to explain how the uniformity of experience happens because of the shared karma. So they have their explanations. But and we also have a lot of questions about it. When someone says that reality doesn't exist, it's only a creation of mind. There are lots of questions can be raised on that. Even in according to science, the reality exists regardless of the observer. Sometimes in quantum physics, you may have heard that when you observe, the reality changes. Now the experiments, even if someone is not observing, how the experiment happens changes while someone is observing. Even it has happened when the cameras were given. Cameras were focused. So such as strange things happen, but it doesn't mean, it means it has a certain effect to the reality. But according to science, the reality is objective. It has an objective existence, regardless of the observer. Observer can make an impact to the reality, but reality is not depending on our observation. So that's why I usually say, when a leaf is falling in the Amazon forest without anyone is being aware, even a ghost is not aware, if a leaf is falling now, it does fall, regardless of the fact that no one is observing. That is the Theravada, the basic Theravada teachings. So then someone can ask the question, is it permanent? And no, they are impermanent, they are suffering, they are non-self, they have momentary existence, knowing this reality is the path. So what is the fault here? Seeing the reality, we consider it in another way, as humans, as a self. Then, what is the reason? The nama dhammas, the mind and the mentalities take this as is so. So what happens? The craving arises, wrong view arises, so the mind process starts to continue. So what we have to do is to know the reality as it is. The craving will be reduced. The enlightenment or the liberation happens. So what are the causes of the four great elements? The question. What are the four causes of four great elements? There are specifically four causes according to Theravada. Some elements are produced by karma, past karma. Some elements are produced by consciousness, mentalities. We call it chitta. Okay, we can call chitta. Actually, it's the chittupada, that mind and the conscious mental factors together. Some are produced by heat. Heat is a great element, and that great element produces some new elements. Some are produced by the nutriment, oja. This happens, the energy produced by, energy is also sort of a rupa, energy produced by the nutriment. So always there has to be a cause outside of these clusters. That is a very basic fundamental of the Theravada teachings. Now, how does the entire world exist according to the Theravada is based on the heat. So always there has to be, if a rupa comes into existence, there has to be a previous rupa that has already existed. While it is in existence, it produces new thing. It suddenly pops up. So for this to happen, there are a different rupa, a cluster of rupas I would call, has to have occurred before this. So likewise, you cannot find the beginning of the universe according to Theravada teachings. It contradicts greatly with the Big Bang. I'm not disproving the Big Bang. I'm not a person to disprove Big Bang. It contradicts. They are not related to each other. The theory of evolution and Buddhism can never come together. Theory of Big Bang and Buddhism can never go together. The physicalism, behaviorism, identity theory, and the functionalism, which explain the consciousness as a physical entity, and Buddhism are completely two different explanations. So so if someone asks how did the rupa comes, it has to come from either from another rupa, nutriment and heat, or either by the consciousness. While we make the movements, I'll be discussing them in detail in the future lectures, and because of the past karma, that's why we are born. The vitality, why we continue to live, because of the past karma. It's not that everything in the world, life is based on karma. Karma is a very vital factor for our life to continue. The most vital factor, I would call. So this is what I would like to say. The four great elements, these are the main causes for great elements. If you think about a generation, there's no beginning, like there's no beginning for the process of generation of chitta according to Theravada teachings. And it's not created by mind. Mind just knows the realities.
Thank you, Bhakti. Sadhu. And the next question is, this question is related to the daily meditation.
Okay.
Do we have to see as it is to the level of Paramattha Dhamma in order to be fully enlightened? Is this the reason why we have to practice Samatha, Samadhi, to the level of laser sharp one object?
Now, I think this question comes whether someone is necessary to see the rupa kalapas or to see the as it is, like someone observes with a scientific experiment through a magnifying glass. Are we supposed to see whatever is happening within the body? No, not necessarily. It's just an understanding. So this understanding can happen in various, just knowing. Now, the example of the car. So car is the object called car. Is something that we create in our mind, but what is its actual existence? A certain hardness exists in the space, in a certain area of space, and cohesion, heat, or they all exist in a certain area. So just knowing that natures means we are going into the paramatta. Just merely knowing that these qualities do exist and ka doesn't exist is called knowing the paramatta. When you know that, when the idea comes that the car doesn't exist anymore in the world, it doesn't really exist, we say we overcome the concept and we penetrate in the paramatta. Now think about our body. If someone can understand that this, the hardness, the body means hardness has been spread in a certain area, it doesn't get scattered because of the cohesion. There is a heat, there is a bloating nature. So if we are able to distinguish these qualities within the body, even without seen them as kalapas, if we are able to penetrate into these qualities, that is the beginning of vipassana. It's not necessarily that you see them in that level at the kalapas and so forth. But when it comes to the anicca dukkha, these qualities we would have to separate that these qualities exist in clusters. There's no need to see them as the kalapas as they are, just mere clusters, and they rise and pass away, or they just change very rapidly, either with direct experience or with the contemplation. That understanding is enough. So I think the question was asked, is it necessary for us to penetrate? Because some traditions, some meditation techniques say that you have to see the reality as it is in the actual form. No, it's not necessarily. If you can, it's better, but if not necessarily for the development of vipassana practice. There are ample of evidences for what I'm saying. So just knowing the mere qualities is enough. The very basic is, if someone understands, only rupa exists, only mere qualities exist, only mind exists, mind and matter exists, and there is no self. That means we are plunging into the ultimate realm. So then you can, because after we get rid of the self view, subdue the self view, they are just mere qualities. These qualities are conditioned by some other qualities, and these qualities are impermanent, suffering and non-self. Then this is the path for vipassana.
Thank you, Bhakti. Sadhu. And the next question is, can Bhakti please once again explain how the Satyasiddhi tradition differs from the Yogacara and Madhyamika?
Yeah, Satyasiddhi, I don't have much information on them. Madhyamika said there are two types of emptiness in them. Emptiness and emptiness of essence. According to the doctrine of dependent origination, realities arises based on other conditions. They are conditioned realities. The ones who are effects of the causes are called conditioned realities. So there is no such a substance called a self that constantly exists or persists throughout the life or throughout the samsara. So that's called emptiness of a self is explained by dependent origination. So the next argument they had was, if something is originated or if something arises from a cause, if B is arising from A, the argument is either B has to come from A, it means B is already within A. So then if B is coming from A, it's not an arising. It's a transformation, or something is coming out of, like a sword, we drag out a sword which was inside the case already. So if B is coming from A, it's not an arising. Then if B is arising newly due to A, as the Theravadians say, they are suggesting that B is a self-agent who is responsible for the arising of B is B itself. B comes into existence by itself, even though it's supported by A. So it's a self-origination is there. How could A, B, which didn't exist prior to its arising, could cause its own arising? That was their logic. So therefore, it is not possible that something that did not exist could come into existence. This is a very sharp argument that they are bringing. Then someone can ask the question, how the Theravadis would agree? Because it makes sense. If something cannot come, if something comes, if Theravadians would say B is not coming from A, but B is happening newly due to A. If A was not there, B would not have happened. So the question comes, what is the real agent of A? Is it real agent of B? Who causes this happening? Is A causing it? Then if it didn't happen, how could A make such a reality to happen? It seems like B is causing its own existence, own arising. So how the Theravadians would explain, B occurs, there is no logic in this, you cannot bring a logic to this. B suddenly pops up, but B has a certain speed, ability to exist, we call it the Uppada Vega. This ability to exist increases and deteriorates gradually, And when it comes in, when it cannot stand anymore, when that power, ability completely reduces, it would fall down. It would completely fall down. So that is called passing away. B passes away completely. So therefore, so according to the Theravadians, what is the contribution of from A to B? It's not A creates B. B gets its ability, upada vega, due to A. If A was not there, B was unable to exist. But still it seems very weird. It can be only, it can only be known, not cannot be explained with logic. So that's why I mentioned in physical science, we have something called a virtual reality. They say it's coming out of nothing. Still the scientists are unable to explain how it happens. So what I want to say is, there are certain things that are we are unable to explain. We are unable to explain each and everything in the world. So therefore, according to the Theravadians, as the Buddha has mentioned, Ahutva Sambhut in some sutras, didn't exist but comes to happen. B happens newly but due to A. The Madhyamikas were arguing, how could this happen? So therefore they mention, this dependent origination is an illusion. It can never be a reality. Because conditioned realities are not possible to happen. They are not possible. They are not logical to happen. It cannot be a factual thing. So they mention, with dependent origination, Buddha mentioned there is no self, like the Theravadians. But they went more further and mentioned that a reality which didn't exist cannot come into existence. So therefore, this dependent origination is even an illusion. That is called, so it's empty. Emptiness of essence. Why is that? The conditioned reality cannot exist in reality. Is when everything is conditioned, each and every conditioned reality cannot exist. So the condition doesn't exist, therefore, because it's also intrinsic nature which arose due to another condition. The conditioned cannot exist. So therefore, this entire thing is an illusion. They are essence, they are empty of essence. This is their main argument. So according to them, nothing exists other than the Nirvana. Then the Yogacharas, now people may have questions, then what is this? How he understands this? So understand, what does it mean by the enlightenment? There are a lot of questions to be asked, and it's a deep philosophy. They do have explanations on this. Then when you come to the Yogacharas, they mention, no, it doesn't mean that nothing exists, because enlightenment has to happen. Understanding has to happen. How do you understand this reality? Is the understanding itself is an illusion? It's another very good question. If someone says all the conditioned realities doesn't exist, how do you understand it? Then who is understanding this truth? If everything is an emptiness, there's nothing called truth. It's just emptiness. So then they mention, no, there has to be something that is the consciousness. We know this reality because of consciousness. So consciousness has to have existence. So they differed from Madhyamikas. So Madhyamikas were blaming, no, you accepted the idea of consciousness, which is an illusion. Their argument was, no, how do you know that this is an illusion? There should be something to know this. So like when René Descartes was in his Cartesian philosophy, when he was trying to understand what really exists, so he started to doubt each and everything. But only thing that he could not doubt was, I think, therefore I am. I'm thinking, I'm doubting in something. So this idea has to be accepted that the consciousness exists. So likewise, the Yogacharas means that the consciousness has to exist. So then everything other than that, as the Madhyamika says, everything other than that is an illusion. And it is an illusion of the mind. It's also a very logical doctrine. So then the question comes, now, while three people are taking a coffee, while someone raises his hand and tries to drink, or when the coffee has been kept in the table, how could everyone has a experience of unity, conformity? Because everyone sees there's a coffee, one cup of coffee, 3 cups of coffees are there, 1 jug of coffee is there, not 2 jugs. When someone takes this jug, everyone knows that jug has been taken. So how do we have that confirmed experience? That is because of a shared karma. When people come together, they are experiencing a same karma. That's why they came together. So when I make a movement, who is together with me would see the same thing because effect of the karma. So that was their doctrine. So the Satya Siddhi doctrine, it says that the 4 great elements do exist. The consciousness do exist. But also he mentioned that when these parts are divided, it doesn't have any specific essence. Same to the 4 elements. 4 elements do exist, but we cannot know it in that way. Even in Sri Lanka these days, some advocate such a doctrine. The outside world exists. Bahidda exists. The rupa, outside rupa, bahira rupa does exist. But it cannot be known in its nature. So what we are seeing is sort of an illusion. So that was a one idea of Satya. I have not gone deeper into the Satya Siddhi doctrine. But I see a distinct difference, a sharp difference from Yogacara and Satya Siddhis. So in the Sri Lanka, some mention in that they are talking, they are advocating the Theravada, they would ironically mention, say that the outside world exists. While we are unable to know it as it is, this experience that we know is the dependent origination. We are unable to know the outside world as it is. If you think our experience is identical with the outside world, that is the delusion, the avijja. So knowing that this is an illusion and not the outside world is different is the path for enlightenment. So there are such monks who belong to the Theravada sect still advocate such teachings. When you go into the Thai tradition, some renowned Mahatheras mention that understanding the world means there is a sort of a consciousness which is apart from the 5 aggregates, which is a bright consciousness, pure consciousness. With it, it is able to see the rising and falling of all these 5 aggregates continuously. But it itself doesn't undergo the phenomenon of impermanence. It is not a reality that arises and passes away. It cannot be classified as a khanda. It's clearly mentioned in this tradition. So that's why my aim was, it was good that you raised this question. Then my aim is to show what the Theravada borders are, at the same time to hint, like roughly mention, what are the philosophies of the other traditions. So we are able to distinguish what Theravada is. It's not to say that Theravada is good, because Madhyamika's logic was very powerful, that argument. How could this happen? How could something that didn't exist come into existence? Who is the agent of this arising? It's a very logical argument. So my purpose is not to say whether Theravada is correct or wrong, or is to prove or disprove it, just to show the borders and explain what the Theravada is. And yeah, thank you for that question.
Thank you, Bhante. Sanu. Then the another question is about the administrative matter, because yesterday you mentioned about the series of the Sinhalese lecture. So this person wants to know if there will be something like an English or the interpretation to those Sinhalese lectures.
I'm going to do the entire Sinhalese course in English in this series. I'm not going to reduce anything. So this this is a repetition of the Sinhalese course, and the English course would have more material, I feel, because I'm doing it for the second time, so with much experience. So the entire Sinhalese course will be done in this series.
Okay, thank you. Please go ahead, Sayali Pumyachan.
Hello, Sayali.
Good morning, Mandy.
Yeah, hello.
So my question is, as Gandhi yesterday mentioned a few times about in the introductory part, so Mandy said, even we are Theravada Buddhist, but sometimes we may follow others' teachings, even their practice, but we don't know. So sometimes some Theras, they also advocate other teachings, but we cannot recognize, or this is the Theravada, or this is the other teachings. So as a Theravada Buddhist, even we say we have to be like a Bahusuda person, but sometimes because we heard many songs, we maybe get lost. So how can we differentiate, oh, this is Theravada teachings, and this is Yogacara's teachings?
Yeah, that was the main reason I started these courses, Yali. That is a very important and a practical question that you are raising, and it's also a very sensitive question, I would call. I would not say people with akusala that you have to listen to various doctrines. Consider it something like an opportunity that you have, you can blossom your wisdom in various ways, looking into various teachings. Because if you look into the Buddha has advised very clearly in the Chula Vaggapali. If you go into Kosambakkhandaka, Mahavaggapali, Kosambakkhandaka, I think you can read by yourself in Pali. It's very important, Kosambakkhandaka. There was a quarrel between the Vinayadharas and the Dhammadharas in Kosambi, and they were arguing, quarreling. And later they came to meet the Buddha to apologize. One had a wrong idea, others had the correct idea. So when they were coming, they brought a great disgrace to the sasana. So they wanted to apologize. So it was the first schism within the Buddha's dispensation, schism. So Venerable Sariputta came, Mahapajapati came, Visakha and Anathapindika, a lot of prominent disciples came. Bhikkhus, Bhikkhunis, Upasakas and Upasikas all came to us. How should we deal with these people? It was a very minor offense, regarding a minor offense. But Buddha mentions the word Dhammavadi, Adhammavadi. I think you know this, you can understand this word. Adhammavadi means the ones who preach the wrong doctrine. Dhammavadi, the ones who preach the correct doctrine. Regarding whether it's Vinaya or Dhamma, whatever it is. Though the incident was regarding a minor offense, you can apply this to the entire doctrine. Because it's very clear teachings has been given. So when Sariputta came, and also the other prominent monk disciples, the Buddha's answer was, how should we deal with them? Sariputta, I have given you very specific guidance. I've given you very specific guidance. How to deal with a monk who is preaching the wrong doctrine and the correct doctrine. So there are Vinaya rules, there are protocols, just follow them. I'm not going to interfere in the Sangha matters. Buddha normally doesn't interfere in Sangha matters, except in very rare cases. Only while he is giving the instructions for the first time, promulgating the Vinaya. So he mentioned, I have already mentioned the Vinaya. You just go and deal with yourself, by yourself, as the Sangha. I have given you the authority, the monks. But when Prajapati came as a bhikkhuni, because nuns are supposed to take owada from monks twice a month. So he mentioned that you have to approach both Dhammavadi and Adhammavadi. And you have to listen to their both doctrines. But accept the Dhammavadi. It means what you think is correct. Use your logic, use your intellect and compare it with my teachings. And then take the advice, the owada. Uposatha Owada is a very specific official one, not just listening Dhamma. Official Owada you have to take from the ones whom you consider as Dhammavadi. Why Buddha doesn't say whom you consider, he just say Dhammavadi. So how to differentiate that whom we consider as Dhammavadi? That's the only way. Then Venerable Anathapindika, the late disciple, and the Visakha came and asked, how do we deal with them? The Buddha mentioned you have to go to both of them, you have to pay respect to both. Offer dana to both groups because they are all disciples of the Buddha, though they advocate a different doctrine. Listen to their Dhamma and carefully try to match it with the basic teachings and try to understand what is correct and what is wrong and accept only the teachings of the Dhammavadis. It means once you understand who are preaching the correct Dhamma. So this is the way. There's no shortcuts for that. Now think about these incidents. Buddha was alive. It was very easy for him because he knows the doctrine. He is the preacher. He is the founder of the doctrine. He could have easily mentioned when the group, two groups were coming, A and B, were coming to Kosambi. He would have easily mentioned A is correct and B is wrong. He would have given the direct answer. But why did he went around the bush? Someone would ask. Why did he went around the bush without being so direct? This is wrong and this is correct. Because he knew this would happen in future. It's obvious. It has happened in every Buddha's teach, dispensation. So in such a scenario, as Sayale asked the question, when we are 2500 years away from the Buddha, in a different country, in a different location, scattered in the world, how could we differentiate the correct from the false? The only way, you have to listen to the renowned teachers. And you also have the Tipitaka within ourselves. We also should gain the Pali knowledge, if possible, and try to apply it. And try always, never put a border or never close the gates that I'm not going to listen to this and this. Always be open-minded. Then, using our logic, using our wisdom, because the final decision has to be taken by the listener himself. Even the preachers, even I say this is correct and this is correct, emphasize on it. If it doesn't fit your wisdom, if you are not happy with that, you're not going to accept it. Even I say 100 times that what I'm saying is correct, if it doesn't fit your wisdom or if you are not happy with that, you're not going to accept that what I'm telling is correct. So final decision is always, in all occasions, is made by the listener. Unless a blind follower who doesn't have the capacity to think. So therefore, the thing is, we have to study. So my approach was, now because I have the expertise in Theravada, expertise means I have studied it, Theravada. So I would give the fundamentals, all the basic fundamentals with references. That is a different, I'm not condemning on others. My approach is, whenever I say something, I prefer as much as possible to give the reference. And I refer to the entire tradition, not only the Tipitaka, the Theravada tradition, with references. In some places I would say, this contradicts with science, this contradicts with the modern, the direct observation. They are logical things, that problems that we have in the doctrine. I would directly express it, but I would always say this is the reference and this is what the Theravadians say. At the same time, give a slight understanding about the other traditions. So it's up to the listener to judge. So I think the timely necessity is at the moment is to show the borders of Theravada, show the borders of Madhyamika, show the borders of Yogacara. You don't need to study the entire doctrine for that. What you have to do is study the fundamentals. Study the fundamentals. It's true that I'm dragging these fundamentals in very detail. Otherwise, I would have done it in a shorter version. But I prefer to do it in detail because some of the wise listeners would have lots of questions to ask. So when I go in detail, everything will be clear. Otherwise, we would have done it in a brief explanation. So the vital necessity is, like we do for Theravada, yogacharas should do their own fundamentals, like arrange them in a manner that is easy to understand. The Madhyamikas have to do it. The Sarvatthivadins have to do it, though their traditions are not living at the moment. Some are still alive in the Tibetan traditions. So even a Buddhist scholars from Theravada can still do it and show the borders. So then the listeners, it's not necessary for the listeners to study the entire doctrines of the entire schools. Just follow the fundamentals and try to be more logical, and you'll be able to understand which teachings are more suitable for the practice. So that requirement is there, that space is still vacant. So my aim is just to show the borders of fundamentals. I accept that in the future, people would also show the borders of Yogacara, show the borders of Madhyamika. So then the listeners would have an easy choice. It's much easier for them to choose which tradition they would prefer to follow, or just they want to take from here and there and follow their own tradition. Some would prefer like that even. And the next thing is, even though I mentioned it as Theravada with with the reference and how I understood it, some may also may explain Theravada slightly differently. There is a possibility. So then what happens, two people are explaining the same Theravada doctrines in different manner. Then we have to argue on this. We have to have a debate on this and to find out whose explanation matches the book. In the end, what we have, the doctrine. There's nothing other than that. The doctrine means the Tipitaka commentary, sub-commentary, and the explanations of renowned teachers. So which is more logical? So that is a debate within the Theravada borders. So in that debate, one cannot break the basic fundamentals of Theravada. So while someone says the outer world exists, if someone says the outside world doesn't exist and it's a creation of mind, both of them cannot debate in the same platform of Theravada, because one is completely out from Theravada. So it is a debate from the yoga, with the Yogacharas and Theravada, not between two Theravadins. So if someone says no, this is not how the Theravada is mentioned in the commentaries, so then it has to be a debate within the Theravada platform. That debate is a different sort, because then we have to go for the references, we have to go to the Pali, the expressions of Pali, the tradition, how the renowned scholars explain. So it's a different sort of a debate. So that, I think, I hope you got the idea. So there is no shortcuts for that, Sally.
So actually I have one more question.
Yeah, we'll make it the last question. Yeah, we made the last question because we have run out of time. Yeah.
So okay, Swami mentioned that you may have different arguments among those schools, but we all accept that Nibbana exists. So in other schools, how do they define the Nibbana?
Yes, Nibbana is something that is beyond explanation in most of the schools. So according to them, as far as I know, Nibbana is a specific state, and Sansara is an illusion, as Madhyamika says, is an illusion. So I'm not aware how they explain about the attainment of Nirvana and so forth, but according to Theravadians, it's the eradication of the non-arisen suffering. So, but according, all of them says the Nirvana does exist. Some I have studied, read, but I cannot confidently say how do they explain the Nirvana in other doctrines. But I'm very much confident that they all explain that the Nibbana does exist apart from the Sansara. The nature of the Nirvana at the moment I'm unable to give you, according to their doctrines. Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much, okay. Sansara.
Thank you so much.
Okay, then we'll call it a day and we'll meet on next Saturday. Yeah. Thank you for joining. Buddha sasanam chiran tittatu, Buddha sasanam chiran tittatu, Buddha sasanam chiran tittatu, sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.